Welcome to Marguerite Soeteman-Reyne, our next female leader speaker of the day. I want to welcome you and introduce you. Marguerite is currently both CMO and chairman of the board at Aon, but also chairwoman of the SER Topvrouwen, and she often speaks on topics like diversity, inclusion, leadership, and she's here today to tell everyone about her path to success and how she has not only learned what career advice works, but also the career advice that you should actually ignore. So welcome, Marguerite. Thank you for joining us, and I'll give the stage to you.
Thank you very much, Merle, and a warm welcome to you all. And before I'm going to do a lot of working, I want you to do a lot of working at home. So can you please put in the chat where you're coming from so that people that we know which countries you're originating from? Because I've seen a lot of names already passing by in the chat, and I noticed that this is a pretty international audience. So let us know where you're from. It's just interesting to watch in that respect what's going on. And I so hope that things are getting in. Let me take a look. Arnhem, Eindhoven, okay. And anyone? Oh, Curaçao, very good. Amsterdam. And is anyone from a different nationality also mentioning? Yeah, Italy. Fantastic. Okay, Porto, Portugal. So we have a very international audience. Congratulations, because the world is international. So it's important already at a very young age to relate to an international global world. And I still, wow, it's Zimbabwe, really a lot of people coming in. Syrian, France. So welcome. So as Merle already pointed out, I've had a long-lasting career. I'm 54. I've actually studied in Rotterdam, and you guys are now looking at a show which is originating from Rotterdam today. I studied at Erasmus Law, and after my law degree, I started working in insurance and have now for 31 years worked for a company called Aon. Aon is a very large advisor in risk and people. And our mission is to empower human economic possibility. Now, the world is full of risks, and we've all seen the past years that with COVID-19, it was a risk, one added risk to a number of risks which we've seen across the globe. We've seen that the complexity is changing of our globe, whether it's geopolitical, whether it's because of regulatory systems, because of cyber, you name it. We've seen a lot of changes, and COVID was added to that. And especially for your generation, that requires a lot of flexibility in the future to deal with what's been going on. And that's what I really wanted to talk to you about a little bit today, is about your attitude towards the change, which is upon all of us. And especially your attitude to how you deal with change is going to be really of very utmost importance for you to build your career. And today we're talking about all those tips and tricks which you can do, how to pitch, you know, what you should listen to and not listen to. But I want you to listen and carefully, and this is the only thing I'm going to tell you, I want you to listen, but you are the master of your own destiny. Each, every individual, each one of you is the master of your own destiny. And you're the CEO of your own career. So while you're the master of your own destiny, your own life, you're the CEO of your own career. And of course, some of you will tell me, Marguerite, but what about health? Very important. That's our biggest lessons of the past year. That's something that a lot of things you can control, but there are also things which are really important, like health, which might be controllable sometimes, but it's sometimes also not. So that's really important to take back. You know, you're the master of your own destiny. You're the CEO of your career. Luck favors the prepared mind was a lesson I learned recently from Stéphane Bancel. And is anyone in the group knowing who Stéphane Bancel is? I think nobody is. Maybe someone from France, because of he's French. I see no reaction. Okay, so Stéphane Bancel is the CEO of Moderna. If I'm asking you what's Moderna, I think all of you will know that Moderna is one of those vaccine producers. But what's really interesting to know is that the vaccine that Stéphane Bancel actually founded the company Moderna some years ago. I see the sound is a bit off. Can you guys hear me? If not, I'm going to be told differently. But Stéphane Bancel is the CEO of Moderna. He worked for a long time in Cambridge, Massachusetts, building his company. And last year, when the COVID crisis hit, he actually converted very quickly. Loud and clear. Here we go. Thank you for mentioning. So Stéphane Bancel, on the 11th of January last year, It was discovered that, you know, it was actually communicated what the COVID genome sequences was. So that's DNA sequences of what the disease COVID really is about. 2 days later, Stéphane Bancel and Moderna actually filed for a patent. And why did they file for a patent? And this is what I want to talk to you about as well today, is because they were already on a lot of data. They had been studying and collecting data in the cloud for years. They were studying 23 different diseases. And when COVID happened, they were able, 2 days after the genome sequences was made known, to file for a patent. Amazing. Now, luck favors the prepared mind. And why I'm telling you this story, because I want you to remember that it's important to know you can control a lot, but luck is also something which is important. And how do I describe luck? It's not only money, it's most important is luck is always something which is very close in your personal life, your friends, your relatives, your family. And so I do hope that, you know, we can give a lot of advices, but making sure that you make the right choices in your personal life as regards partners, you know, it's pretty important, has a huge influence on your performance as well. So in the diversity and inclusion world, which we currently live in, there are a lot of things are being said about women at work. Today we're talking about women's careers. And there are some people who are saying women are not interested in a career, are not interested in one of the top roles. Huh? And you're all wondering here, like, you know, is that what some people might think or say? Indeed, this is what some people are saying out there in the big market where you're going to step into very soon or you might already be working on. Now, a reaction to that is, that's not true. I think women often react a little bit more modest, a little bit more, you know, observing than men who might be really running off. So you might want to be aware of this because it's important to note that this is something which might affect you someday. There's always an argument when you take a look when people are being hired, like a second notion is that we want the right person on the right spot. That's a very legitimate excuse for when once they start to select women in the workforce. Of course, you want the best person at the right spot, but it's very important. Do you know whether the best person is in the Netherlands? He might be in the US, so that's a very awkward way to position it. Statistically also, it's not correct that the right person often is a man. So just be aware that this is statistically an argument which doesn't hold back. And so it's actually something which you just need to be aware of. It's really important that more and more, you know, we start to create an equal environment of 50-50 of men and women working. So if you're going to select a company to work for, take a look how that company relates to 50-50 workforce, how, you know, who's sitting at the top. Are those people the people you actually think yourself in? Do you recognize values you think are important, etc. So some of the things you might encounter is also that they might say, like, yeah, women are not really leaders. Huh? Women are not really leaders. Now, we all know we've seen a number of female leaders, you know, the past year. We've seen Angela Merkel, Miriam already mentioned Christine Lagarde, etc., etc. And interestingly, there's a study of two very famous professors called Volkmann and Zenger, and they identified 19 leadership skills amongst men and women. And interestingly, out of those 19 leadership skills identified, women score better on 17 of them. Just so women are no good leaders is an argument you can simply push back as well. So what we see is that from time to time, there's more discussion around masculine and feminine capability skills that you might have. And especially the past year, we've seen a real uplift in all those feminine capabilities and character traits. And that's a very interesting one, because in 2005, just before the financial crisis, and some of you might have still been at school at the time, the majority of the world appreciated male leaders more than female leaders. In 2010, just after the financial crisis, they even appreciated more male leaders than female leaders. So, however, this year we've seen that there is a change, that there is really a change where we see, you know, the feminine capabilities and skills of leaders are really being much more appreciated. Now, in my opinion, it's very important to have both of the skills. A feminine skill is empathy, and as you know, a masculine skill is command and control, but it's really something you need to be aware of. And as I said already, as you're the master of your own career, this is about you. Who are you? And what is you? What are you about? So I think what's also important to note is that back to leadership's capabilities, take a look at yourself. Who are you? What are your capabilities? And how does it relate to the bigger world? Now, then there is always something which being said, yeah, women can be doubtful. You know, women say that I need to think about a job. You'll see this happen. This happened also 4 years ago, you know, when we had the new government being appointed 4 years ago. It was said that they couldn't find women. Now, that's another argument. There are women plenty enough. We have a full database. There are artificial intelligence, which you can find CVs of women you can check. But it was also said that, yeah, women are also hesitant. Yes, you know, we're not hesitant. So it's definitely a no. Are you hesitant? No. But we actually think more carefully about the decisions we make. And we balance them really carefully out. So, but when women are being approached for a job, they're more visible because they're not. They're still more men. Now, so I've mentioned a number of these things. One of the other things which you might experience already at your age is that they say when you start applying for a job, your experience, we're looking for a candidate with more experience. Now, so just that you realize this is an argument, especially at your age, I'm already saying, guys, how much experience do you need to have? And that is arguable, but it's also arguable whether the experience people carry, whether it's really relevant. So if you have any of those situations coming across to you, then be prepared to discuss it also. You know, and this sounds a little bit awkward to say discuss it because you might say, yeah, though. But, you know, be also now, stand up for yourself. So I call this be bold, be brave, and be brilliant, and just do it. So if you know you want something really hard, go for it. Even if you think, like, I don't have the right qualification, I think Elina elaborated on the imposter syndrome. You know, it's very important. I think one of the most important things which is important for any individual is self-confidence, knowing who you are with the pros and cons which goes along. But back to experience, experience doesn't say all. Somebody might have had 20 years experience in insurance, but if he hasn't done his job appropriately, the experience is not really valid. So just that you realize that. Now, what's also something we see more and more? So for me, diversity is really about something which is for men, and it's something you need to do together. So it's for males and females. You know, we talked a lot about the business case. Half of the population of the world is female. Half of the population is male. All facts we're all familiar with. It's important to have if you take a look at what's really important now for the world, for profitability, prosperity, for people and planet, all going together, is to make sure that there is a balanced decision-making process in companies, corporates, or in the public sector. And that balanced decision-making process is only happening when you actually engage appropriately with diverse perspectives. Now, so that's why it's important. That's why I was asking, where are you guys coming from? It's important to be aware of the diversity which is in your team, but it's also important to listen to the diversity of team, not only to have the numbers, which is diversity, but also to include it, which is actually what we call culture and attitude. Fijke Siebesma, some of you might have heard of him. He's going to be the president commissioner of Philips, president chairman of the board of Philips. He's always saying, like, be very much aware of the unconscious bias. And the unconscious bias that we relate to is that, you know, there might be a party of recognition. I might know Elina from university, from students' time, might be fun, etc. But I might be biased then more towards Elina, to choose Elina, than anyone else. So it's very important that you really look at, you know, the objective measurements in order to make the right decisions. And it's just important, you know, even if you're aware of the fact that all of you have an unconscious bias. So one of those advices which I've received the past years in my life, which I really could have done without, and that's something, you know, that's why I'm so active for diversity. I've done very well, you know, Miriam talked about meeting Christine Lagarde. I've met Hillary Clinton. I've met all kinds of sportsmen, Lewis Hamilton, you name it, wonderful, fantastic rock star life. But what's really important, though, what's triggered me really from all the things I've encountered? One of them is that failure builds character. So if you have anything which is going wrong, you know, get your act together, pick up the pieces, stand up straight again, and continue. Don't give up. And so, you know, if you want to find find a shoulder to cry, and even if you want to cry in front of your boss, cry, just pick up the pieces, you know, stand up and go on. So there's a Japanese saying, which is resilience is 7 times falling down and 8 times standing up. And that's really a very, very important one. If you talk about mentors, and me, I'm talked about mentors, I want to rephrase it a little bit, because sometimes a mentor can, you know, can have a soft, in some companies, mentees, you know, that has a kind of soft element with it. So I always say, like, look for, if you want to call it mentor, but I always call it a champion. Look for a champion. So someone who can help you, who's going to be your brand, loyal brand communicator in the company, to help you make the right steps at the right time, to communicate and sponsor you, to tell stories about you. And he's then committed to you. So you should share with him the things which are important to you, the things you would like to achieve, so that he can also influence others. Really important is that you actually make sure that others know your story or know your ambition, and that others also preach for you the ambition. The thing I could have done without is that people have said to me, like, yeah, Marguerite, change the way you speak and change the way you dress. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm very passionate. I always speak with my hands. And if you go to certain countries, geographies or corporates, you know, you talk like this, you behave like this, you're wearing dark clothes, so, you know, black jackets. That's something which I could have done without, because it affects your confidence. So I'm going to tell you, each and every one of you, if you want to dress in a certain way and it feels, makes you feel happy, do it the way you want to do. And, you know, make sure that, you know, if you want to lean in some organization, then, yeah, of course, you might want to need to change some of it, but be yourself. I think that's really important, that you need to be yourself. And this is also an element of change the way you speak, is that from time to time, women are being told that, you know, we are always apologetic and we're more assertive and we say, oh, I'm sorry, and we shouldn't say I'm sorry. You know, let's not talk about what we should do. Let's talk about what other people should do. And I'm not talking about fixing the women or fixing the men, but I think we should fix the system. So I think we should tell each other if it's necessary to change the way we speak because it's not appropriate, etc. We should openly open up. And especially on this one, I'm sorry to say this open. I think that sometimes men, incompetent and inappropriate men, should be edited more often than that. We should say not to say sorry. Yeah, so why is this actually a thing which I'm raising? Because there are still a number of countries and organizations which have great difficulty that if there's a certain behavior, and we've just not so long ago seen it in the United States with the president, that it's really, you know, it's really difficult to restrain some powerful men, their reactions and also their actions. So, but it's important to address. A lot of people have also, from time to time, I'd say, like, yeah, you should be more confident. To be honest, I don't think that it's a problem of our confidence. I think it's more that it's not a problem of our lack of confidence, but I think it's maybe more that the man's oversupply of confidence. And those lack of confidence and surplus of confidence is actually both a problem. So I think all of you are wish for that you have the right amount of confidence. Is that, you know, which aligns with your actual competencies. And one thing I've written down here, and I want to tell you this, is that be aware of your own flaws. So this is something which I think is important. Accept them. So if you're too assertive, if you're too introvert, accept who you are, because then you're always in your strength. And try to balance it out into such a manner that, you know, you do aspire and achieve what you want to achieve, but that you balance yourself out, that you're always showing your true yourself in every situation. Because self-deception is really the enemy of personal development. Now, yeah, so I think that if I conclude a little bit, because I really want to engage with you some questions. If you take a look back at the business case, you've seen that, you know, the economics speak for itself. McKinsey calculated that, you know, if the potential of females is actually utilized in the Netherlands, it would add $114 billion to our gross domestic product worldwide. If we would use the female potential, it would even grow further to $28 trillion. So take a look, what are those numbers? We have half of the population as females. Even more women enter universities and graduate from universities at the moment than men. We know that the past year has shown us that society doesn't accept any situations like with Black Lives Matters. You know, equality is a big issue. It's a big world item for each and every one of us. Why don't we have it if it's also even written in our constitution? You know, equality, gender, equal treatment is a thing which is described as the law of students, as you will know, in our constitution. And so there's a moral appeal for me to make sure that, you know, it happens. Now, we have in the Netherlands at the moment a discussion around the law, which would enable a 30% quota in non-executive boards and supervisory boards of listed companies. The Senate is going to give its insights around how they relate in a few weeks' time. So really important things are going on. And it's really been shown that if you take a look at other countries around us, like France, like Germany, if you have quota, that actually does help to overcome a barrier which has been there for a long time. And especially in the Netherlands, we've seen that the surroundings, which I've grown up with, was pretty conservative. You know, women were supposed to stay home and not to go to work. You know, I went to work. I've been working my whole life full time. And it's a choice each and every one of us should make on your own merits, together with your partner, together with your family, whatever you want. So what do I wish for all of you? That, you know, that you follow your own destiny, that you master your own destiny, that you try to really make sure that you, that you luck favors the prepared mind. So be prepared. Make sure that you do the right things to do how you pitch. Make sure that, you know, if you're in an elevator, that you're able, you know, within 1 minute to do the elevator pitch on who you are. Try to be unique. Each and every one of you is unique. That's why the world is interesting. I think that it's really important that, that you make the world equal as it should be. Your generation is now really much more informed, much more balanced at universities, at all kinds of things you're doing. So I wish for you a very good future. So Merle, I'm seeing some questions coming in.
Yes, definitely. Thank you, first of all, for sharing all these insights. And indeed, a lot of people are asking some questions. So I'll start at the top. Michelle is asking, and you've already touched upon this topic, of course, is it true that women have to work harder to prove that they are capable of leadership positions than men? And if so, do you have tips for this?
Yeah, so I think that one of the studies shows that women are more educated than men. So we've done more education. If you take a look at my LinkedIn, you know, it's just embarrassing. I've been to every university you can think of in the world. Yeah, but yeah. It's always embarrassing, you know, it's like, and then because I thought at the time that, you know, by getting all that education in, that it would help me to get a better career.
Yes.
It does help me from a content perspective, because that's what's important. What do you really want to get out of? The value is content, is do you know what you're speaking about? Back to the advice. So I think that it's really important that you make sure you know what you're talking about. You distinguish yourself if you have a lot of different angles. You know, I've been on exec at a hospital, at an entertainment park, so it brings value to a lot of other discussions. But I think that would be good to make sure that you know what you're talking about, but don't over-educate, because also there's research that it doesn't pay off in salaries back.
Right. And then Sarah is asking, and I think she might even be speaking from her own experience. She's asking, how should I act if I suspect that I was not considered for a role because of my gender? What should she do?
So at the moment, you guys are living in an era where everything is discussable and it's very transparent. You know, social media hits a company. Each company has a reputation to lose. So if you really feel like that, you should definitely first talk to some others to take a look whether your opinion, whether that's objectively true.
Yeah.
The question is then, you know, do you still want to pursue your career with a company who's done that to yourself? That's question one you should ask yourself. Do you want to spend energy on that? Question two, three, if you want to spend energy and feel like you want to change and make the world really a better place, then you should address it and go and have a dialogue. And ask the questions. But I already gave a lot of those little things, you know. It's really, if you take a look at how women have been bypassed, so Miriam also said it's very important to be visible. So don't only manage your career nicely and your family life, but also manage the ecosystem. Make sure you're visible. Do make sure that people know you for your content at LinkedIn or social media. You guys have a lot more opportunities than we had in our time. I had to write like Miriam. I wrote a book. I wrote a chapter for a book. You know, I've been, so it's all kinds of stuff. You don't need to do that anymore. You have a different way of putting yourself on the map and use that opportunity to do so.
Exactly. Ola's asking, who is the most inspiring woman for you and why? And she's thanking you for such a nice workshop.
Yeah, so thank you. So I have many role models, but I'm also going to say something. We had a recent discussion with a group of women. We said, like, role models? No, we need real models, you know. So role models are something like, I don't play a role. You will see me like this now, but also in an hour's time, I'm always me. And what I wish for each and every one of you is to be me. And so if you ask me, like, who inspires me? I'm inspired by Simone. I've mentioned this also in some of the interviews. I'm very inspired by Simone de Beauvoir, because she was, as you know, and you might have read books of her, but she was the lover of Jean-Paul Sartre. Jean-Paul Sartre, a very big philosopher, and so was Simone. But she was really struggling with, is a woman an object or is it subject? And while she was writing very feminist books, she struggled in her own relationship how to address this. And this is why it's so interesting. So if you take a look at each and every situation, if I look in a situation like, how can I be a good mother? I might look at somebody who's a good mother. If I look at who's a good businesswoman, who's a good businesswoman? So you can have different situations where you have different people to look up to or to inspire. And I've always been very much inspired by Simone de Beauvoir, by Margaret Thatcher. You won't know her, but she was a tough iron lady and really a tough cookie at a time when there were only men. And also Hillary Clinton, who I think already said I met her. And
yes,
really had a tough time when her husband was caught cheating. You know, and how she bounced back. And that's why I say, you know, make sure you're resilient. 7 times falling down, but 8 times standing up is really the most important part.
Exactly. So looking for people that are having real experiences and not the so-called perfect role model experiences.
You know,
Yeah. And so, which kind of is in line with that, Anik is asking, do you still encounter moments where you feel insecure? And what do you do when you have those moments?
Yeah, so that's why I said your partner is important. My husband is a pilot. He's also old. He worked at the Navy also before that. And so if I've learned to ask him for some opinions when I feel like I perceive something like this, and then I'm asking him for his how he perceives it. And I've really discovered that there's differences between men and women. And yeah, if you have someone to talk to, you can actually take a look like, how is another person reacting? One of the things which we've talked about Black Lives Matter, something which was just a very interesting unconscious bias. We have been all growing up with Sinterklaas in the Netherlands, and we never experienced until a few years ago when it started happening, you know, with Zwarte Piet, really like how people of color actually experience something like that. So it's very important to have a diverse perspective. If you want to take a look at what's going on, have a different perspective. Don't take your own opinion for granted, but try to learn. And I think that's what's really important. Have the curiosity to find out what might be there as well. You know, have the intelligence to adapt to change. You know, have a learning attitude, which is really important. You know, you can keep learning your whole life. So I really want, you know, if I'm telling you what's important, be modest, be curious, try to learn your own life. And try always to take another look, like, what's the different perspective and what am I not seeing? What's my blind spot in this opinion? And then it's really interesting. That's why I'm saying Black Lives Matter. It really has changed my opinion on Zwarte Piet the past year. And I was raised with, you know, and so it's really like, okay, I see then so much hurt in how people were actually affected by it. And this is the same for females in our world of business. Some of our females have experienced awful situations which we don't wish anyone to encounter anytime, anytime, anywhere. Yeah.
Okay, and then I think we have time for one last question. Let me just have a look.
Marilyn, do you mind if I had the Krabbeman? So somebody's asking how it would women amongst each other. So I don't mind so much about competition amongst men or women, or I do appreciate loyalty. So, because there will be women you like, there will be men you like, but there will also be women you dislike and men you dislike. That's life. So, I do like loyalty. I think that, and a nice example, so yeah, I think it's important to realize loyalty is important. Take a look whether you can support another woman, and the quota, just to make sure that everybody knows why the quota is 30%, because there's a research from a person called Daderup, and he actually investigated, like, when is a person being heard? So if you're one female on a board of 10, then your voice is not being heard. Only when there are three females in a board of 10, 30%, then that other voice is being heard. And so that's why also in diversity numbers, the number of 30% comes up, because then people start to not only hear a message, but also receive the message.
Exactly. Okay, well, I think indeed you already saw the same question I did. I don't think we have any other questions left. So I really want to thank you for your time and for your presentation and your very valuable insights. So by now, I've said this a couple of times, we'll take a couple minutes break, and then I'll be back with our next female leader, which is Ellen de Weert. So thank you again, Marguerite, and everyone else, see you in a couple of minutes.